Good afternoon. Thank you for joining my talk about giving voice and action in React and React Native. My name is Wouter, or Walter as they call me in English, because I'm from Holland, I'm Dutchy, and Wouter is a real Dutch name. I'm a freelance developer for like 15 years, and also 15 years in the mobile space, and also some web development as well. Like I said, we're going to talk about voice. Of course, everybody has one, and some are a lot louder than others, of course, these days. But I'm talking to you about voice input and later on some output as well. And I'm going to try to convince you to use voice in your projects or in the products you make. And it has had everything to do, of course, with the voice assistants that came along those last 4 years. Of course, those are dedicated voice devices, but also mobile has its own voice, and also the web these days has voice in their browsers. So what we see is they took some surveys, and what you see is that voice already is used a lot. Like I said, you have voice assistants, which usually are dedicated devices. And I'm not getting why it's only 97%, because there's nothing else you can do with a voice device than using it as a hockey puck, I guess. So I don't know what the other 20% is using them for, but not voice. mobile is already has also a great user base of using voice. And another part where voice was introduced, I think already like more than 10 years ago, is in the car. Car systems, the in-car systems used voice as well a lot, although they didn't work that great at the beginning. These days they are really better, but there's also a voice command usage there. And on mobile itself, what you see is that almost 90% of the world has a mobile phone these days, which is, of course, really great, but also that's a lot of people. And almost 60% of them has used voice once or multiple times, but tried it to use it for a command or something else. So it is a really big user base you can touch if you use voice in the right way, of course. And also, they ask what kind of assistants or what kind of uses do you have mainly. So, of course, Apple is at the top because I think they have the greatest marketing budget of the world. So I guess they use it as well for Siri. The second one is, of course, the Google Assistant, which is on Android. And you see that Amazon is a small part of it because it's not really used on mobile phones. And the other ones are like non-existent in this space, so we don't need to take care of them. And they also asked where you use those voice commands. So when do you use voice? Now, in the car, I already talked about it, because that's hands-free, of course, is really great for doing voice commands. But also in the house, which is, of course, the assistants and the HomePod or whatever you use at home for voice is also really, really big. But also there are some nice ones like cooking or in bed, which is also a very good use case, I guess, for using voice, because you don't have to get out of it, I guess. So there's a lot of use cases where you can use voice for your application. But how does this voice thing even work? So that's the general sense. Now, the magic word, of course, is machine learning, because everything these days is machine learning. But machine learning improved the language processing by a great lot the last years. That's why there's such a great improvement in voice recognition, mainly, also by also for understanding what people are saying. So, and the main piece or classification they use is natural language processing. So they do that by different types which you see here to combine them together. And the first thing you do, of course, is getting from speech to text, because computers use text for input, not voice itself. So what mainly is the first step is getting that voice, which can be, of course, a recording or something from your mic. And what they do with the machine learning part is first enhancing the text from yourself, so that what is speech and what is ambient sound. Then it will try to see if what words or phonemes, because phonemes are groups of words that are most likely the same and they have the same characteristics. So they would try to put them together in groups, and with machine learning they will group them together and see if they can classify them for a purpose in your sentence. So not every word, of course. Some words look the same or our sound is the same, like eight is like eating. So they try to get the context in your sentence as well to see if you mean the number eight, or that you are eating or have had some breakfast. So that's what they do, and then try to make that out of, into a text sentence. And of course, the scoring in that sense is improved a lot in the last years. And what you see is that the languages they used in the first day, of course, we had English. But now we have multiple languages, and what you see is that the more phonemes a language has, the more difficult it is to get it right. English has, I think, about around 36 phonemes now. I think Norwegian is 44, and something like Lithuania has 77. So that's a lot. So that's why I think Lithuania still doesn't have text recognition or speech recognition, for it. And the second part, what most assistants do, or what the tools, the machine learning does, is getting the right intent, as we call it, for that thing you are saying. So what does the user say, and what action can we involve out of that? So this is also something machine learning did for us, is getting that better and better to see what in the text you said is the thing you want. So in this example, you see there is a place, multiple places even, there is a price. So machine learning does what it does. It has a neural network of things it thinks you are saying, and then it will run them. I think it runs 1,000 or even 10,000 of those algorithms in a neural network for you before it says and classifies not really the right one always, but that it thinks that it is the right one and classifies it as the highest. So, and with those classifications, we as programmers, but also the assistant itself, can say like, okay, this is what you mean and this is the action I'm going to invoke. And that's the last part with an assistant, or with most voice things, is that we have an action, and that can be anything you want, of course, but usually it's getting something from a web server or opening an app or doing something with that intent you pronounce to it. Because I was talking about React Native, briefly, because I think tomorrow are some more talks about React Native as well. Briefly going to say what React Native is. Of course, React itself is a JavaScript framework created by Facebook, I think already like 6 or 7 years ago. And the React Native part, because that's what, and this runs in the browser, and the React Native part is for mobile applications, or even these days desktop applications. It uses the same thing that React does, as the same idiom, but it has different outputs. So it has views instead of diffs, and it has different controls like the native parts have. It uses something that they call the JavaScript core, which is like the engine which takes the JavaScript you put to it, and you can convert it, or you can run it on a different thread or a different process than, for example, a web view, because web view is just a browser, and everything is in there, and JavaScript code is just the tiny bit you need for JavaScript to run on a very high performance level. It is on iOS and on Android. On Android, Facebook went to the great lengths to make it in their own JavaScript core, which is called Rumish, which is like 3 months old, which improved the performance a lot. And for example, Microsoft has their own JavaScript core as well, which is called Chakra. And they use it for example, in Office. Microsoft Office also has React Native in it to get some views, etc., in there as well. So it is a great piece, missing piece. This is how it works on mobile. I'm not going too deeply into that because, like I said, there are some different talks about it tomorrow. But we have the JavaScript side and we have the native side, and there is a bridge between them to bridge the gap so that both sides know what to do. In the demo, you will see something like it. And those are parties that are using it at the moment. So, and it's one of the main reasons I used it is that you can use it for an whole app, but you can also use it for like a small piece of your application, and that's really convenient because a lot of screens that are created let's call it content and marketing screens. So as a developer, that we don't want to be developing that, so we outsource that in that sense to web developers or the marketing team to just create screens, etc. for that. Now, but where can we use voice, or where can we use it for? For one company I use for, we have a platform which is called ClinicArts, which is a medical platform for patients who are trying to get better, of course, but also need to input a lot of vitals. And we are experimenting there because usually patients have accessibility, need great accessibility, and we are trying to get to use voice for different parts in the application. Or in the platform itself, to get a better response from the patients and better entries. Although there is a warning, let's see if the internet works. Don't use it for critical parts of your system. That's the reason why I'm always showing this video, because if you do, you get something like this. If it doesn't work, and that's with voice, sometimes it doesn't work because your voice is different. Of course, you have to take that into account that, yeah, it doesn't work, so you need to have some manual entry as well, or your normal entry in that sense. So what we did with the experiments for ClinicArts is the dictating. So it's, of course, that's a handy tool to get speech to text to fill in some entries. Of course, the keyboards these days have this as well for on iOS and on Android, and even I think on the desktop as well, you can dictate it and then the text will appear on your screen. We tried that as well, but if for ClinicArts, for example, we have values like blood pressure, which are not really text-free text field, so we needed to have some control over what's going and on validation as well to see if it's valid. So that's why we try to do it ourselves. Invoke some action in your application that can be like opening a screen or an action, or instead of pressing the button, just saying that you want to press the button. Invoking the application in total, that's something Siri, for example, can do for you, but you can then handle it in your application to go to the right screen or to the right, or show the right little button or whatever. And last bug is getting feedback with voice, so you do voice synthesizing and say something to the user, like if something is done correctly, just congratulate them, I guess, or something else. So for the first thing, there's the speech to text. It is these days it's natively available. So that means almost every system you can think of, like mobile and desktop, but also in the browser you can use it. It's mainly for the 20 languages it's supported on device. There are more languages, but then it needs to, for example, it needs a better internet connection, or because it's going to send to the server. But most English, etc., are mainly on device these days. And there are some libraries in React, because I was talking about React, for it that handle those use cases for you, so you don't have to write everything yourself. Let's see if we can have a demo. I'm doing the native part now. I also have a web part, but I'm not going to show you. I can show you that later, but I'm trying to focus on the mobile part first. Create a simple class and saying like I'm using React Native Voice for this one, saying that I want some speech results, of course, and the only thing you need to do then is say like I want to start the voice recognition, and you have to put in a language because it's not smart enough to see what language it is, because some languages are really the same, some of course aren't, but the most are the same for them. So usually I'm doing the saying what voice or what language it is, and for the rest it's more like listening to it and setting, I think it's I think that's it already, because it's just showing you the results in text. So underneath that, it's using the for Android, it's using the speech recognition of recognizer, as it's called, class, and on iOS it uses the SF speech recognition. Let's see if it works today. This is the greatest mobile conference there is. Not totally right, I think. I think it has a lot of echo, of course. So, I think that's the main thing, of course, with voice, is that not always. And also, I'm not a natively speaking English, of course. So if I'm doing it in the Dutch, I think my performance will be better. So it's really easy to, just with a few lines of code, you can already see that you can input some text, and you can, of course, validate it, etc., etc. It's really, really, really easy to do these days. And if you use the native parts, it's the same thing. It's just setting the recognizer, and then getting the text from it, and you're done in that sense. The second thing, of course, when you have some text, sometimes you want to do something not only dictate, but you want to do something with it. We call it intents. This is usually done by some online services we have on the the internet. It cannot be done by the NLP service on the device yet. What I used for the demo is with AI, but also there's IBM Watson, and there is I think Google Dialflow also has some recognition as well. It is very, it is of course it is just like the recognition part, it's language specific, so you have to say which language you want to do, and it is also very specific for your app, which means that if you use such a service, they are going to ask you for what you are trying to, what task, for example, you want to complete, and what words need to comply with that. So in my demo, I will do a location. So what it then I will ask is, give me some sentences with, not with the word location in them, but which are defining the location, or which defining this intent. So on location, for example, you can say, what is my location, which is very, of course, very obvious. But also, where am I is not something with location in it, but the services, if you enter that, the services know, oh, this is also something that needs to go to the intent location. And what we did with our experiment is just brainstorming all the sentences and words we could think of about what you're trying to achieve, and then put them all in those APIs, and then try to get it out there with the testers, and then try, and when the tester of did use them, we also recorded that the sentences and see if they fit it, and entered them. If it's because users or test user users have of course other perspective how to pronounce things, but also how to go somewhere. So they have sometimes have sentences that I don't, or that we think that is a little bit off or not really obvious to get to that action. Let's see. Yeah, well, I think, like I said, I used With AI for, which is from Facebook as well, which is handy, by the way. So, this is the easiest one you can get, because it's just saying what does this app want to understand, and you're going to and you can tell it's like where am I, which is my location, where I need to go, or where are thou. So those things you can enter here, and then you can specify which entity, which is the intent you want to do, and then it will calculate with this machine learning. It will calculate the intents if you put them put some text in it later. So that's what I done with the demo. Is of course the first thing is the same thing. It's like getting my voice into text, and eventually fetching that intent by just sending the text I have, which is the result, just sending that to the with API services, and I will get some intent back, and also a confidence, so it gives some confidence with how good it's thinking is doing by performing the job of getting the text into that intent. And then here I'm just launching the current location I have. So let's see if that works. Where am I? Yeah, of course, it's Apple. Well, that's of course obvious. So it's just getting out there to with AI and saying with this, but I can also maybe another sentence. What is my location? And of course it will. But if I say something else, it shouldn't do it, of course. Let's try it, I don't know. Let's see. How are you? Still doing it. Then I have too much things in it. That's also a false positive, of course. That's why I'm always trying it to get it out of the way. So this is how you should. But also with AI, you can cancel those intents if you want to. So if some sentences aren't correct, then you can move them, or you can assign them to another one. So like how am I is like something like different, of course, a different action. You can invoke the application. Of course, that's something on iOS that's done in the last 2 years. It's main focus of Siri, of course. And you can just say to Siri or to the platform like iOS, like I have a voice command, and if you do this, then come to my app to open the application and give extra parameters, etc., and then I will open the right screen or whatever. Google has the same thing. It's called voice actions, but at the moment it's a little bit restricted. You can only do it on multiple tasks that they defined. So on iOS, it's really, yeah, whatever you want. But on Google, it's more like, I think it's an alarm you can set. If you say like something on Android, set an alarm, you can say my application can open because somebody said so, or set the alarm sentence. And there are I think there are 5 or 6 of those predefined ones. So it's a little bit, it's really restricted, and not really for our use case. It wasn't appropriate. On the web, we don't have it something like this at all, of course, because my web browser doesn't have Siri in it. And what we found is that with the test users, it's really hard to explain to users that it's there. And because it's not in your application, it's more getting to your application. So if people like are really really Siri users in that sense, I think they will know it. But most, like we have patients, are normal users in that sense, not tech savvy users. They don't know that it exists, so they don't know that that's a feature that you can apply to your application. So we made some, of course, some explanation screens, etc. But it was really hard for people to know that it was there and also to use it. So let's see if my demo works today, because of course it's voice. How does it Siri? And I think the Android one does almost the same thing. Is saying that you have an intent that it can action on. So this is what there is a lot of code, of course, for just that. But it needs to have some. Of Siri does need some input for it. Of course, the main ones are the activity type, because then it knows that it's my application, and all the persistent identifier is the same thing. Those two things combine it to my application. The other ones are more like the user info is what extra information is getting sent to my application at when it starts. And the other ones are more how it will look in Siri itself. So this is iOS 12. They changed it in iOS 13. So in iOS 13, it's in the shortcuts application. It's a different application. But in iOS 12, it was in the settings. I don't know why, but it was in the settings. So here you have the one I created, because when I start, like for example, when I start the application, I say to him that this is one of the suggested shortcuts I have, and the suggest and donate are almost the same thing. It's just letting the system know that I have a Siri shortcut in it. And then it's just listening to that shortcut, because when it comes, like I said, when it starts, you can just check for those extra parameters, like what is the activity you want and what are the extra values in it, in that. And then just start your screen or whatever it is, and then and on Siri you can then add them and just say a sentence, doesn't matter really what, and then it will start your application. So let's see if that works. Who is on stage? No, it's opening the browser, but not really in the browser. But that's mainly a minor detail. So it starts your application, and you can go to a different screen or open something else if you want to. So that's how it works on iOS. And like I said, on Android, it doesn't work at the moment in this because the limitations. And the last part is giving some voice back to the user, which is usually, of course, reading text aloud in some voice you have. There are, I think, on iOS there are like 60 different voices already in different languages. On Android it's around 40, and in the browser it depends on the browser. If you have Chrome, for example, there are like, I think, 200 voices in it, from computer to weird Chewbacca's, I guess. But for example, in Safari there is, I think, a few. I think 10, something like that. So it depends on the browser, which browser you have. So on the browser you have, you can get a list of the ones that are there, and then just say something with it. It's all on device, so you don't need an internet connection for it at all, because it just works for most voices. It just works. Let's see. And for this, it's just one line of code, because it's just saying what text do you want to say, and then just giving the voice. This looks really ridiculous, of course, but this is one of the voice names they have out of the list. I just picked one, and then it just speaks to you. So it in most on the web it's the same thing. On most languages it's just one liner, because it's already there in the system. And it's used also for other accessibility features as well on iOS and on Android. I don't know if it works, but let's see. The greatest person. Oh, yeah, I'm too fast. The greatest person in the room. His Norwegian is really bad, I guess. So, but of course, like I said, some are. This, I think this one is an English or a general one, and they have specifics for each language, most languages as well, so they have better pronunciation, of course, than this. And we use this mostly for supporting the user when they've done their task for the day, or when we want to ask something of them, like enter a value in a screen, or a value for a day in a screen, then we ask for it instead of that we just do a notification or whatever. And most users liked that because it wasn't that prominent in their face, but they just heard it. But other users didn't because they were deaf. Now, that was true. There were really deaf people in it, but also because they didn't have the sound on, for example. So not all people have sound. So with this is the same thing. Don't use it for critical parts of your product or system because, yeah, users use it in different ways. So to summarize, like I said, voice is getting bigger and bigger. It's, I think most people know how to use it these days. Implementing it is very easy, maybe except for the intent part, because that needs some work. But it is really easy to get it going for dictation or for getting to giving some voice back to the user. And as mentioned before, don't really use it for critical parts, because nobody wants to not be understood in their own language. Thank you very much. And some questions, I guess. We have time for questions, so if somebody has questions, of course.